Welcome back guys, this is Vishu from SavageCamp, and in this video we are going to cover the deployment types and the cloud types of any infrastructure. Now if you are new to this channel, I am putting together a list of videos that will help you become an infrastructure engineer. I have already covered the responsibilities for this role and also the Linux networking and storage skills that you will require while working this role. Now in this video we will go over the deployment types of any infrastructure and also the various cloud types that you will see in any infrastructure. So let's start with the deployment types first. So let's start understanding the deployment models for any infrastructure. Now the thing that you have to note is these three deployment models will be across all the companies. And it wouldn't be like there are some companies that follow these three and there are other companies that follow something else. This is something common that you will see across all the companies. Now let's start with the first one, which is the cloud one. The cloud deployment model basically is when the company decides to put everything on cloud. And by everything, I mean everything. All their servers, all their databases, all their storage, and all of their networking stuff. But which company would do this? Well, it's very easy. When you have smaller companies that cannot invest in data centers, that do not have money to allocate resources inside the data center or pay for like a rental space, what these companies would do is go to the cloud and put all of their data in the cloud. Now, not a lot of companies can do this because a lot of companies can be handling sensitive data, which is why you will see the cloud model deployed in mainly startups and smaller companies that can afford to put their data on cloud and work through the cloud system. So that's the cloud deployment model. The second one is called on-prem deployment model. In on-prem, you basically have data centers that you have physical access to. So there are various data center companies that will buy a lot of space and then they will create data center. They will manage the power, they will manage the security, they will manage the networking inside the data center. What you have to do is buy out a space in there and you put your servers in there with other companies. The good thing about this model is you have physical access to the data center. Like you can walk into the data center with your badge and basically say, I am an employee of this company and I'm here to get into this server. And they would allow you if you have proper permissions. The security is one of the biggest concerns when it comes to data centers. And that's why giving it to some other company is always better because you don't have to handle all of the risk that comes with this. But again, when you are giving it to someone else, you have to pay money. And also it's a trust issue because you don't really know if they would be fooled by someone and someone can come get access to your servers. So there's always a risk factor, but this is on-prem. Mostly all the big companies are still on-prem because they are afraid to move the data to the cloud, or their compliance team does not want the data to be on cloud, because when it goes on cloud, it's basically out of your hand. You do have access to a lot of stuff, but it is sitting in AWS or Google or Microsoft's data center, which is not with you, and you don't have access to those data center. You cannot go to the AWS data center and say that, oh, I have AWS servers, so I need access. It won't work that way. So this is the on-prem model. Mostly all the big companies would have this. And the third one is the hybrid model, which is a mixture of both on-prem and cloud. The sensitive data that these banks and insurance companies or other mortgage companies that have your SSN, they cannot put all of this data on cloud just blindly. That's why what they would do is they would have the critical data on-prem in a data center that they can manage or they have physical access to, and they will move the applications that don't have critical data or sensitive data into cloud. So this is the hybrid model. So now that we have covered all the three deployment types, we will go into the three types of cloud computing that you will always see in any infrastructure. So before we go into cloud computing, we need to know what cloud computing is. Now you must have heard this term cloud a lot in the last 5 or 6 years. So the easiest way to describe cloud is like basically using someone else's service. So when you say a server is on the cloud, the server is not actually sitting on the cloud. It's actually in a data center that is managed by AWS. The only reason we call it cloud is because it is always available for us. So as a consumer, you can see up and you can see the cloud. And when you want any service, you can go to AWS and you can use that service anytime you want. And I think that's why they call it the cloud, because it is highly available at any time you want. And it is always there, and it is available across the world. Like, you can create a server in Tokyo, you can create a server in Sydney, you can do whatever you want anywhere in the world when it comes to cloud computing. So why do we need cloud computing? Let's go over this first. Well, in the traditional way, whenever you want anything, you basically have to put an order, wait for the order to be shipped, and then once you get it, then you have to see if everything is over there. If they miss something, then you have to tell them again. Then you have to wait another few days for it to come, and then you have to check again, and if anything is faulty, you have to complain again. So there's a lot of back and forth, and it actually takes like few days for anything to arrive when you order it from a warehouse or data center. So what cloud computing does is it will give you anything you want right away. And when you say that I want 10 servers, the 10 servers would be available to you within 10 minutes. You can configure the 10 servers in any way you want within 10 minutes. And the beauty of cloud computing is that you pay as you go, which means that if you're using the server for 2 hours, you'll only pay for 2 hours. So the easiest way I can tell you this is it's like Uber. So suppose I want to go from Chicago to Michigan and I don't have a car. So I'll go to a car dealership and I'll say I want this car. So they'll do a background check. They'll ask me for all the documents, like the bank documents. So once they have all the paperwork, they'll send it to the dealer would approve it. Then they will send out a card from the dealership to the showroom. All of this will take a week. If I'm being generous, it takes more than a week to do all of this. But if I want to go from Chicago to Michigan, I can call an Uber and just take the Uber. So instead of buying a new car, I'm renting a car. The same goes with cloud computing. Once you're done with your work, you just turn it off. You don't have to pay for it anymore. You can literally spin up hundreds of servers for 1 hour, do your work, and bring down those 100 servers. And you will only pay for 1 hour. And the three main types of cloud computing are infrastructure as a service, platform as a service, and software as a service. So we'll go over all of this in the next section. So let's start with infrastructure as a service. Now, we can make a whole video just covering this topic because there's a lot of things over here. But in this video, we will just cover the overview. So I'll tell you basically what infrastructure as a service is. So suppose I work in a company and I want to order 10 servers. So suppose I call Dell. So Dell will place an order to their warehouse that there are 10 servers that needs to be shipped out to my company. The warehouse will get that order the next day. They will start building up these servers. Then it would take like a day or two. Suppose everything is ready in a day. The next day it will get shipped out. The shipping usually will take 3 to 5 days because these servers are heavy and sensitive and they can't just be thrown over and sent overnight. So 3 to 5 days for shipping. Once it comes to your data center, you will get a phone call that there's a big package for you. You'll know that, oh, it's the server that I ordered a week ago. So you will have to send your people to the data center. The people will go in there, check all the servers are there, and they would start racking the server up. That would take a day. And then they will call you and be like, the server is up, you can start doing stuff on it. So we'll start installing the operating system, then we'll do some tests, and then finally we will have the server ready to be used. But this whole process took like around 10 to 15 days. And if there's actual shipment delays, or there's the weekend when nobody works, it would take like 2 to 3 weeks to get servers. But what these cloud providers do is they will give you this whole infrastructure, because when you order a new server, you will also need to manage the switches. So there's a lot of things that is required while installing a new server. But when it comes to cloud computing, what these companies are doing is they are giving you the infrastructure. So you basically go into the AWS console and you will be like, I need 10 servers. And within 5 minutes, your 10 servers would be up with whatever configuration you need. It would be all up in 5 minutes. And then you are like, oh, I don't really need 10 servers. I just need 5. You can shut down and terminate 5 of them and those servers are gone. But when they are like physical servers, you will have to send your people in again. They will have to remove the server. They will have to ship it back to the warehouse. The shipping will take a few days. So all of this is a time consuming problem, which infrastructure as a service will solve for you. So they basically give you an infrastructure where you can deploy your own servers of whichever type you want, and it will be ready in a few minutes. Infrastructure as a service basically gives you the whole infrastructure on a few clicks of buttons. So that's the beauty of infrastructure as a service. So let's move on to platform as a service. So let's talk about platform as a service. Now we covered infrastructure as a service, where it would basically give you an infrastructure and you can design the infrastructure in whichever way you want. You can install 10 servers, 5 networks, you can install like 10 subnets, 2 load balancers, you can install 6 databases, you can do anything you want because it is an infrastructure that is given to you basically like a blank slate. When we come to platform as a service, it means that they are going to handle the platform for you to run your code. They are going to handle the infrastructure, they are going to build the infrastructure, and they are going to provide you a platform where you can run your code. So I work in Python, and someone is like, Vishu, here's a Java code that you can run and it would do this for you. And I want to run the Java code, but I am a Python developer, so I will have Python installed on my laptop. What I can do, instead of going and installing Java, I can move to one of these cloud services. I can use their platform as a service on Amazon or Google Cloud, and I can run the Java code over there. So they will handle the servers, they will handle JVM, they will handle the jar file, they will do everything. All I have to do is provide them with the code, and they will basically provide me with the platform to run that code on. So when you use platform as a service, it's basically taking out all the tedious stuff that you have to do before running any program. Some of the examples of platform as a service is like Heroku or Google App Engine or Red Hat OpenShift, Elastic Beanstalk. All of these are giving you a platform to run your software. So it takes out all the work of bringing up a server, installing all the dependencies, installing all the compiler interpreters. It would remove all of this. You would just be like, I need to run a Node.js application. I need to run a Java application. I need to run Angular. So I don't need to install anything. I can just specify what I want, and they will basically provide me with a platform to run my code in. So that's platform as a service. And in the next section, let's see what software as a service is. So let's cover software as a service. This is the one that is very easy to understand, because in the last two parts where we covered infrastructure as a service, you basically get a blank slate of infrastructure and you can design your infrastructure in any way you want. When it comes to platform as a service, they handle the infrastructure and they give you a platform to run your software. Now the third part, which is software as a service, is basically they will just give you the software to use and you will only pay for whatever you use. So suppose I'm an accountant and I work in a small business and I don't have a Microsoft Office license because it's too expensive and I'm only going to use it during the tax season, which is once a year. So for using it one time, once a year, I have to pay for the whole year. This was the conventional software model. When it comes to cloud computing, you have software as a service, which follows the pay as you use method, which is nothing but whenever you use, you pay for that time. So you don't pay for the whole year, you don't pay for the whole month, or you don't pay for the whole day. If I use the software only for 1 hour, I'll be only paying for the 1 hour that I use the software for. Now, some of the examples of software as a service is Zoom or Shopify or Office 365. So that way, software as a service is basically they have the software ready for you and you only pay for the time you use. So this is again something that we'll cover in the future videos. This is like an overview, but I think that's it for the three types of cloud computing models that you will always see in any infrastructure. And it's very important to know why these are used and why we move to something like pay-as-you-go model instead of using the conventional license models. And if you like this video, just drop a like, comment with any questions you have, and subscribe if you want to see more content. I'll be going into details into all of the things that I've covered in the past videos. So that's it for this video, guys, and I will see you guys in the next one.